York. This is Democracy Now!
Today we mark a truly grim, heartbreaking milestone. 500,071 dead. That's more Americans who have died in 1 year in this pandemic than in World War I, World War II, and the Vietnam War combined.
After a devastating winter surge, the U.S. COVID death toll has passed a staggering 500,000, by far the largest in the world. As the U.S. ramps up its vaccine rollout, the United Nations warns far more needs to be done to help protect poorer nations.
The world urgently needs a global vaccination plan to bring together all those with required power, scientific expertise, and production and financial capacities.
We'll speak to New York Emergency Room Dr. Craig Spencer, a survivor of Ebola himself, about the coronavirus pandemic at home and abroad. Then, as we continue to honor Black History Month, we remember the visionary Black feminist science fiction writer Octavia Butler. She died 15 years ago this week, but her readership continues to grow. One of her last television interviews was on Democracy Now! In 2005.
Choose your leaders with wisdom and forethought. To be led by a coward is to be controlled by all that the coward fears. To be led by a fool is to be led by the opportunists who control the fool. To be led by a thief is to offer up your most precious treasures to be stolen. To be led by a liar is to ask to be lied to. To be led by a tyrant is to sell yourself and those you love into slavery.
We'll hear Octavia Butler in her own words, some of her interview never aired before, and speak with the author and activist Adrienne Marie Brown about how Octavia Butler's writings can help the world tackle some of its most pressing issues today, from climate change to racism. All that and more coming up. Welcome to Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. The United States recorded another 1,400 deaths from COVID-19 Monday, bringing the U.S. toll since the start of the pandemic to more than 500,000, by far the highest of any nation in the world. The bells at the National Cathedral in Washington, D.C. tolled 500 times Monday to commemorate the 500,000 people who've died in just the last year here in the United States. That's more people than the entire population of Miami, Florida. In a sunset ceremony at the White House, President Biden, Vice President Kamala Harris, and their spouses led the country in a moment of communal mourning.
So today, I ask all Americans to remember. Remember those we lost and those who left behind. But as we remember, as we all remember, I also ask us to act, to remain vigilant, to stay socially distanced, to mask up, get vaccinated when it's your turn. We must end the politics and misinformation that's divided families, communities, and the country, and has cost too many lives already.
President Biden has ordered flags on federal property to fly at half staff for 5 days. The number of new COVID-19 cases continues to fall across the United States, and the vaccine effort is speeding up. In Connecticut, health authorities say they'll now administer COVID-19 vaccines based solely on age, eliminating priority status for most essential workers, with residents 55 and older and teachers prioritized, this starting March 1st. After headlines, we'll have the latest on the pandemic with Dr. Craig Spencer, who's been treating coronavirus patients for the past year. President Biden's nominee to become the next attorney general, Merrick Garland, told the Senate Judiciary Committee Monday he would prioritize prosecuting the white supremacists who stormed the Capitol January 6th. He compared the task to his prosecution of the Oklahoma City federal building bombing in the 1990s. Garland said he did not regret seeking the death penalty against bomber Timothy McVeigh, who was executed in 2001, but said he's since altered his views on capital punishment.
I am very concerned about the large number of exonerations that have occurred through DNA evidence and otherwise, not only in death penalty convictions, but also in other convictions. The data is clear that it has an enormously disparate impact on Black Americans and members of communities of color. And exonerations also, that something like half of the exonerations had to do with Black men.
In an emotional moment, Merrick Garland said he felt an obligation to pay the United States back for granting asylum to his family.
I come from a family where my grandparents fled anti-Semitism and persecution. The country took us in. Protected us.
Can you look? Today, the Senate's Energy and Natural Resources Committee holds confirmation hearings for New Mexico Congressmember Deb Haaland to become Secretary of the Interior. If confirmed, Haaland will be the first Native American to serve as Interior Cabinet Secretary. California Attorney General Javier Becerra faces 2 days of Senate confirmation hearings starting today on his confirmation to lead the Department of Health and Human Services. He helped lead the fight to defend the Affordable Care Act from attacks by former President Trump and the Republican Party. He's also voiced support for Medicare for All in the past. Meanwhile, the Senate votes today on whether to confirm Linda Thomas Greenfield for U.S. Ambassador to the United Nations and Tom Vilsack for Secretary of Agriculture. Canadian Prime Minister Justin Trudeau is meeting virtually with Joe Biden today, who's carrying out his first bilateral meeting as president. The two will meet, well, not in person, as the U.S.-Canadian border remains largely closed due to the pandemic. They're expected to discuss vaccination campaigns, the climate crisis, and Trudeau's opposition to Biden's decision to cancel the Keystone XL pipeline. The meeting comes a day after Canada's House of Commons voted to declare that China is committing genocide against more than a million minority Uyghur Muslims in Xinjiang province. The non-binding resolution passed on a vote of 266-0, although Trudeau and members of his cabinet abstained. The Supreme Court has refused to block the release of former President Trump's tax returns to a grand jury convened by Manhattan District Attorney Cy Vance. Trump blasted the move in a statement calling it a threat to the very foundation of our liberty, unquote. New York prosecutors are investigating hush money payments made to adult film star Stormy Daniels during the 2016 presidential campaign and whether the reimbursements made to Michael Cohen, Trump's former lawyer and fixer, were illegally accounted for as a legal expense. The Federal Aviation Administration's grounded dozens of Boeing 777 passenger jets after an engine failure on a United Airlines flight Saturday nearly led to disaster.
United 328 Heavy, Mayday aircraft just experienced an engine failure, need to turn immediately.
The pilots of United Flight 238 are being hailed as heroes after an emergency landing that saved all 229 passengers and 10 crew aboard. The explosion occurred just minutes after the plane took off from Denver's airport bound for Hawaii. Scattered engine parts fell across a swath of the city of Broomfield, but no one on the ground was injured. The National Transportation Safety Board says a preliminary investigation found the engine, manufactured by Pratt & Whitney, showed signs of metal fatigue. This follows two fatal crashes of Boeing 737 MAX jets in Ethiopia and Indonesia that killed all 346 people on board. The UN High Commissioner for Refugees is calling for help finding a group of Rohingya refugees who've been stranded at sea off the coast of Bangladesh after their boat broke down Saturday, leaving them adrift without food or water. Human rights workers say at least 8 people have already died on the boat, which is carrying refugees believed to have left from Cox's Bazar in Bangladesh. Cox's Bazar is home to the world's largest refugee camp, with a population of some 1 million Rohingya. In Colombia, an inquiry by a special court has revealed the Colombian army carried out over 6,400 extrajudicial killings known as false positives between 2002 and 2008. The army then falsely deemed their victims as leftist rebels in order to boost their combat kill rates and appear as if they were winning Colombia's half-century U.S.-backed conflict against the Revolutionary Armed Forces of Colombia, known as the FARC. A peace deal was signed in 2016. In the Democratic Republic of Congo, 3 people were killed Monday following an ambush on a UN humanitarian convoy in the eastern region of the country near the city of Gorna. Among the dead was the Italian ambassador to Congo, Luca Attanasio, and a Congolese driver for the World Food Program. The group was headed to a World Food Program initiative at a school when their vehicles were reportedly hijacked by unidentified armed men. Several others were injured. Over 2,000 people in eastern Congo were killed in brutal attacks by armed groups last year, and over 5.2 million have been displaced. In Haiti, massive protests continue demanding President Jovenel Moïse step down, accusing him of illegally extending his term. Hundreds of people took to the streets of Port-au-Prince Sunday as mobilizations entered a third week. This is one of the protesters Sunday.
We, the young people, are the path to liberation of Haiti. We will continue fighting until we regain sovereign status, because we know it is the Americans, foreign powers, the Organization of American States, and the UN who are supporting President Jovenel Moïse. It is they who support these thieves. I send a message to Joe Biden and to them. I know that our resources interest them, but we continue fighting to regain our sovereignty.
Israel's warning people to stay away from beaches after an offshore oil spill began polluting a 100-mile stretch of Mediterranean coastline. The massive tar slick has devastated ocean wildlife, including sea turtles and a 55-foot fin whale that washed ashore dead in southern Israel. It's being called one of Israel's worst ever environmental disasters. In Texas, environmentalists are sounding the alarm over toxic pollution from oil refineries that scrambled to shut down amidst last week's unprecedented winter storm. Reuters reports Texas refineries turned off or flared more than 250,000 pounds of toxic benzene, carbon monoxide, hydrogen sulfide, and sulfur dioxide as temperatures drop below freezing. Meanwhile, households and local governments in Texas continue to report astronomically high energy costs after Texas's deregulated energy market allowed for a huge spike in prices. The publicly run utility in the city of Denton was charged $207 million on energy costs in the last few days, more than its entire annual budget. United Nations investigators have found that Eric Prince, a Trump ally who founded the mercenary company Blackwater, broke a UN arms embargo on Libya by supporting a militia commander who was seeking to overthrow Libya's internationally recognized government. The New York Times reports a confidential UN investigation reveals how Eric Prince deployed mercenaries armed with attack aircraft, gunboats, and cyber warfare capabilities to eastern Libya at the height of a major battle in 2019 in support of renegade former general Khalifa Haftar. Prince faces possible UN sanctions, including a travel ban and a freeze on his bank accounts and other assets. In Colorado, an independent investigation into the police killing of 23-year-old Elijah McClain has found Aurora police officers did not have the legal basis to stop McClain or apprehend and assault him. The report published Monday says McClain's encounter with the police was a violent and relentless struggle, and that the limited video and audio available from the incident, quote, reveal Mr. McClain surrounded by officers all larger than he, crying out in pain, apologizing, explaining himself, and pleading with the officers, unquote. McClain was stopped by 3 police officers on August 24, 2019, as he was walking home from picking up an iced tea for his brother at the local convenience store. He was tackled by police, placed in a chokehold, and was then injected with ketamine by paramedics. He died on August 30th after days on life support. Virginia is set to become the first state in the South to outlaw capital punishment after lawmakers voted Monday to abolish the death penalty. Democratic Governor Ralph Northam has pledged to sign the legislation. Virginia has carried out nearly 1,400 executions since 1608, when it became the first British colony in North America. And in New Jersey, Governor Phil Murphy signed three bills into law Monday legalizing and decriminalizing marijuana. The legislation creates a regulated marijuana industry and addresses the disproportionate arrests of people of color over marijuana possession. On Monday, Governor Murphy said the move was long overdue.
As of this moment, New Jersey's broken and indefensible marijuana laws, which permanently stain the records of many residents and short-circuited their futures, and which disproportionately hurt communities of color and failed the meaning of justice at every level, social or otherwise, are no more.
And those are some of the headlines. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the quarantine report. As the COVID death toll passes a staggering 500,000, we'll speak with New York emergency room Dr. Craig Spencer about the pandemic at home and abroad. Stay with us. By the influential, pioneering Jamaican reggae singer U-Roy, who's died at the age of 78. This is Democracy Now!, democracynow.org, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. It was a year ago when the United States confirmed its first COVID-19 death, and then President Trump vowed the coronavirus was, quote, very well under control in our country, unquote. By the time President Joe Biden took the oath of office last month, the U.S. death toll from the virus had crossed 400,000. In the last month, 100,000 more people have lost their lives. At a sunset ceremony at the White House, President Biden, Vice President Kamala Harris, and their spouses led the country in a moment of communal mourning as COVID deaths passed 500,000.
Today, we mark a truly grim, heartbreaking milestone. 500,071 dead. That's more Americans who have died in 1 year in this pandemic than in World War I, World War II, and the Vietnam War combined.
Biden has ordered flags on federal property to fly at half staff for 5 days. The number of new COVID cases continues to fall across the United States, and the vaccine effort is speeding up. This comes as the world, as the head of the World Health Organization, is calling on rich countries not to undermine efforts to get vaccines to poorer nations by buying up billions of doses, in some cases ordering enough to vaccinate their populations more than once. For more, we're joined here in New York by Dr. Craig Spencer, Director of Global Health and Emergency Medicine at Columbia University Medical Center. He's been treating coronavirus patients since the pandemic began a year ago. His recent Medium piece headlined, "Global Vaccine Inequities Are Dangerous for Everyone." Dr. Spencer, welcome back to Democracy Now! This is a horrific milestone. Half 500,000 people dead in the United States. We have less than 5% of the world's population, but about 20% of the world's deaths and infections. How did we get to this point?
You know, a year ago, I remember in New York City, we hadn't had a case yet. We had been hearing about cases all around the country and obviously all around the world. Italy had been hit hard, was starting to be hit really hard. And we were prepared here. We knew that things in New York City would get bad, but we had no clue that they would get as bad as they got. And we certainly didn't think that it was going to be this bad all around the country for so long. You know, part of that is because this virus is really good at what it does. You know, less than a year ago, Dr. Fauci said we may have 240,000 deaths. We've doubled that already, and there's certainly going to be more. But obviously, and what I've been saying over the past year is that a lot of this, you know, this death toll and a lot of this destruction that this virus has wrought on this country and this world was because of our failure to adequately respond and to treat this like the public health crisis that it was. You know, so much over the past year, we have undermined the scientists. We have, you know, belittled the public health measures and the things that we could have done to get this virus under control. And because that wasn't done largely by this last administration, the Trump administration, what we have now is we have, as you've already noted, the most cases in the world, the most deaths in the world. And, you know, now passing this grim milestone of over 500,000 Americans and counting who have died from a virus that we could have certainly controlled a lot better had we taken it seriously a lot earlier on.
I want to ask you about vaccines, the first about what's happening here and then in the rest of the world. You have two vaccines that have been approved in the United States. We still don't quite understand what it means for the vaccines to outpace the variants, the British variant, the South Africa variant. Are they going to have to change the formula in these vaccines to deal with this? And those that have these vaccines, will they have to get new shots? And then how do more Americans get shot at this point?
Those are all great questions. And the one thing that I want to point out, because this can be a little unclear, right? We see a bunch of different headlines and are the vaccines working? Are they not? Let me make this very clear. The vaccines that we have right now, the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccine, are both extremely, extremely, extremely effective at preventing you from getting infected with COVID and fantastic at preventing hospitalizations and deaths from COVID. I mean, they are truly miraculous. And the fact that they were done in such a short period of time is a game changer. So I want to encourage everyone to please get vaccinated when it's your opportunity to do so. Now, there have been some concern because there are these variants. We've heard of variants that have emerged out of the UK, out of South Africa, now some out of California. There will likely be many more. And there have been some studies, both in the lab as well as, you know, in a larger population, showing that for some of the vaccines, their effectiveness may be blunted by some of these variants. That being said, they've still all prevented hospitalizations and they've all prevented deaths. You know, the fact that there have been no deaths and no hospitalizations in severe cases in the vaccine arm of these research trials is truly, truly remarkable. So, yes, there will have to be some update likely over the next year. And perhaps even going on in the next few years in terms of the recipe or the formula for some of these vaccines. We know right now that they're very protective, and we know that the FDA has already, has given guidance saying that we're not going to have to go through and do these whole 30,000, 40,000 person trials like they did initially for these vaccines. They'll be able to tweak the vaccine like they do on an annual basis for the flu shot, which would make it a lot easier for us to get this kind of this updated vaccine out to make sure that people are protected should variants emerge that undermine the efficacy of these vaccines.
So these vaccines are based on a new technology, messenger RNA. That's Moderna and Pfizer. On Friday, the FDA advisors will be meeting to discuss emergency use authorization for Johnson & Johnson's COVID-19 vaccine, which is adenovirus. Is that right? Can you explain the difference? That also is a one shot.
Absolutely. So the Pfizer and the Moderna vaccines have up until now been a bit complicated because they were two shots. They had previously been required to be at these really, really cold temperatures that made it logistically difficult for many people. The beauty of the Johnson & Johnson vaccine is that it is a well-known older technology that has been shown to be very effective. And as you pointed out, it's a lot easier to transport. It's a lot easier to manage. It's a lot easier for, you know, smaller places, rural pharmacies, places internationally to manage. And it's also great because it is just one shot. So you get rid of all those logistics of thinking about whether people need to come back in 3 weeks or 4 weeks and what happens if they miss that or it needs to be delayed. So there are multiple, thankfully, multiple vaccine candidates on the horizon. Hopefully we'll get a little bit more nuance in terms of which ones are better for certain populations. But what I've been telling people right now is that if you are due to get a vaccine, if you're able to get a vaccine appointment, you should take whatever vaccine you can get. I wouldn't wait to try to get a Pfizer or a Moderna or a Johnson & Johnson. All of them, I want to repeat this, all of them have been proven to prevent severe COVID, prevent hospitalizations, and prevent people from dying from COVID, which is obviously the most important as we pass this horrible milestone.
You wrote in your Medium piece that's headlined, "Global vaccine inequities are dangerous for everyone." I've personally received more doses of a COVID-19 vaccine than 130 countries. Dr. Spencer, explain.
I was lucky enough as a healthcare worker here in New York City to be part of the initial phase of the vaccine rollout. I was extremely eager after having seen and been at the bedside of so many people dying over the past year from COVID and worrying every time that I went into work that I'd get sick myself and pass it along to my family. I was one of the first in line to get vaccinated when I could. That was 2 months ago. And in that time, there are still over 130 countries that have not received a single dose of vaccine. There was at one point, just a few weeks ago, you know, we're the only country in sub-Saharan Africa, one of the only countries in sub-Saharan Africa to get vaccinated was in Guinea, and they received 25 doses, not 2,500, not 25,000, but 25. You know, we all knew that there was going to be an inequity. We knew that wealthy nations were going to gobble up vaccine doses like they've gobbled up many other technologies for time immemorial, quite frankly. But the inequities that we've seen here are just absolutely stunning. You know, the wealthy nations and advanced economies have bought up well over half of the vaccine doses via, you know, pre-purchase agreements, despite representing a fraction of the global population. Now, part of that is because COVID has been worse in places like the UK, in Europe, and in the United States. But that does not mean that it has not touched sub-Saharan Africa and other places around the world. There's been nearly 4 million confirmed cases in Africa itself, with over 100,000 deaths. And there's concern about a recent rise in cases there as well. My concern is that I've been vaccinated, thankfully, but my friends who work in a clinic in southern Burundi in East Africa may have to wait until 2022 or 2023 before they have a chance to get a vaccine, even as we're being promised here in this country that everyone will have a dose by July. And we have, via pre-purchase agreements in the United States, ordered way more vaccine doses than we have people who are even eligible to receive them.
According to President Biden, what, 600 million doses the U.S. should have by July, which would mean 300 million people vaccinated if it's two shot. Of course, one shot, then it's way more. But explain why people who in this country only care about what's happening here, even using that criterion about survival of people in the United States, the worst in the world, should care about what's happening to people all over the world?
That's a great question, right? Because we have seen so much pain and suffering here at home. We've seen what's happened with our economy. We haven't been able to eat in a restaurant. We may have lost loved ones. It's easy to see the proximate impact of COVID here and why we all wanted to end as quickly as possible. You pointed out the 300 million people by July will be able to get vaccinated. Well, that's just for adults, right? So that's 260 million people that we actually have eligible for vaccination in the U.S. We haven't done trials on kids yet. So that means we have 40 million more doses just of Pfizer and Moderna than we do people who will be able to be vaccinated by that time. We also have Johnson & Johnson doses, others, you know, hundreds of millions of other doses that we have ordered. Now, we can hold on to them and hoard them, or we can think about how we get other vulnerable populations around the world vaccinated. There are 59 million healthcare workers in the world. We could take a very small proportion of the doses that we have ordered, and we could help coordinate a program with the World Health Organization, with other international health bodies, to get those most vulnerable people in the world vaccinated so that not only are we safe here at home, but others are safe everywhere else. Now, there are other reasons why that's important. Stopping the virus from replicating in Missouri is just as important as stopping the virus from replicating in Mozambique. You know, the more that this virus has a chance to mutate, to replicate, it has more of a chance to mutate. And that's where you can get these concerning variants that may develop in other places that could land here and could possibly undermine the efficacy of our vaccines. The other really important thing is that we all want to get back to work. We think that getting vaccinated may be really the jumpstart to the economy here in the U.S., but so much of what we rely on in our U.S. economy comes from abroad. You know, car parts from other countries, everything that we need largely comes from other places. And if those places aren't able to get back to work because they're still dealing with COVID outbreaks, the economic toll here in the U.S. could be huge. It's estimated that, you know, up to $9 trillion hit on the economy will occur in 2021 alone if we continue with this vaccine nationalism, just gobbling up all of these vaccine doses for use in wealthy countries and not thinking about other economies and other people around the world. The economic devastation could be huge, not just in those places, but here as well. So it's in our public health interests, it's in our economic interests, and I think most importantly, it's really in our ethical and moral compass to be doing this. This is part of our role.
And finally, this has exposed the racial disparities in healthcare and economic disparities in this country, to say the least, like an X-ray. Dr. Spencer, can you talk about something that is left out of, I mean, in the networks, the corporate networks, there is a lot of discussion of the horror in this country. But what about the solution? What about Medicare for all?
It is unbelievable to me at this point that despite being the wealthiest country in the world, despite spending the most on healthcare per person by far of any country in the world, we still have tens of millions of people who every day remain unprotected and uninsured. Look, as you pointed out, this pandemic has really shown a light on how bad that was. We've seen Black and brown populations who've been disproportionately impacted by the impact of this pandemic. A lot of that was because, yes, the virus itself and the conditions around it, but because of the system that existed and the infrastructure that existed or didn't exist for those populations beforehand. We need to do everything we can to recognize that, again, like vaccines, the economic benefit would be huge of making sure everyone had health care. We need to, from a moral and ethical perspective, to make sure everyone who lives in this country has access to a doctor and doesn't have to worry about going bankrupt because they're looking for treatment for something that has ailed them and prevented them from either working or going to school or contributing. It's absolutely essential that on the other side of this, we don't just go back to normal, because normal was absolutely unsustainable, completely unacceptable, and we need to reimagine how we get everyone part of our economy, part of our workforce, but most importantly, healthcare, and make sure that we provide, I think, really what we should assume are the fundamental tenets of an advanced and humane healthcare system here in the U.S. And that doesn't happen until everyone is covered and has health insurance.
Dr. Craig Spencer, President Biden has called this a war on the pandemic. Could you imagine a world where the United States pushes vaccine, both giving and selling vaccines around the world, as hard as it pushes selling weapons of war?
Well, we certainly would be a lot safer if we got everyone vaccinated. Look, there's been, you know, here in the U.S., we've had 500,000 people die. We've had at least 2.5 million people die from COVID around the world. We've had over 100 million infections. And look at the economic impact that this has had here in the U.S. $3.4 trillion already passed in stimulus, another 1.9 likely coming very soon. You know, the impact has been huge, greater than many, many, many wars. It is imperative that we get COVID controlled here in the U.S., but it's also imperative that we get it controlled around the world. And in addition, how we think about how we prepare and respond to the next crisis. We can't build walls or tall enough or moats wide enough to keep out the next invader, whether it's a microbe or a virus. We need to be prepared because we will see this again. We've had multiple public health emergencies of international concern over the past 6 years. We will have more of them again. We need to be prepared and make those investments now. Part of that is making sure people here at home have access to health insurance, as you've already pointed out. But part of that is making important investments in getting people vaccinated around the world, helping build health structures and health systems that can detect and respond to those threats before they reach our shores.
Dr. Craig Spencer, I want to thank you for being with us. Director of Global Health and Emergency Medicine at Columbia University Medical Center has been treating COVID-19 patients since a year ago, almost exactly. Next up, we honor Black History Month by remembering the visionary Black feminist science fiction writer Octavia Butler. She died 15 years ago this week. Stay with us. Walking in Your Footsteps by Toshi Regan. This is Democracy Now!, the Quarantine Report. I'm Amy Goodman. To mark Black History Month once again, as well as the 25th anniversary of Democracy Now!, we turn now to one of the last television interviews given by the visionary Black science fiction writer Octavia Butler. In November 2005, she came into Democracy Now!'s old firehouse studio. Just 3 months later, Butler died on February 24, 2006, after she fell outside her home, outside of Seattle, Washington. She was 58 years old. Butler was the first Black woman to win the Hugo and Nebula Awards for science fiction writing. She was also the first science fiction writer to receive a MacArthur Genius Fellowship. Butler's best-known books include the classics Kindred, as well as Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents, two-thirds of a trilogy that was never finished. Published in 1993, Parable of the Sower is set in the 2020s in California. That's right, the 2020s now in California, amidst a global climate and economic crisis. Octavia Butler described them as cautionary tales.
They were what I call cautionary tales. If we keep misbehaving ourselves, ignoring what we've been ignoring, doing what we've been doing to the environment, for instance, here's what we're liable to wind up with.
In her books, Octavia Butler also wrote about slavery, about fascism, about religious fundamentalism, and so much more. Her work inspired a new generation of Black science fiction writers. She's been called the mother of Afrofuturism. And Octavia Butler's audience has continued to grow. In September, she made it the New York Times bestseller list for the first time, 50 years after she began writing and nearly 15 years after her death. Democracy Now!'s Juan Gonzalez and I interviewed Octavia Butler in November of 2005. It was shortly after Hurricane Katrina devastated New Orleans. President George W. Bush, the former governor of Texas, was in the White House overseeing the U.S. wars in Iraq and Afghanistan. Part of this interview aired live, but some of it has never been broadcast before.
How did you first start writing science fiction? You grew up in Pasadena. How did you first become attracted to that type of writing?
I think I loved it because, I fell into writing it because I saw a bad movie, a movie called Devil Girl from Mars. and went into competition with it. But I think I stayed with it because it was so wide open. It gave me the chance to comment on every aspect of humanity. People tend to think of science fiction as, oh, Star Wars or Star Trek. And the truth is, there are no closed doors and there are no required formulas. You can go anywhere with it.
We're talking to Octavia Butler. Her latest book is Fledgling, wrote the Parable series as Katrina was happening, then the aftermath of Katrina. A lot of people were talking about Octavia Butler and how the Parable series made them think about that. Explain.
I wrote the two Parable books back in the 90s, and they are books about, as I said, what happens because we don't trouble to correct some of the problems that we're brewing for ourselves right now. Global warming is one of those problems. And I was aware of it back in the 80s. I was reading books about it. And a lot of people were seeing it as politics, as something very iffy, as something they could ignore because nothing was going to come of it tomorrow. That and the fact that I think I was paying a lot of attention to education because a lot of my friends were teachers, and the politics of education was getting scarier, it seemed to me. We were getting to that point where we were thinking more about the building of prisons than of schools and libraries. And I remember while I was working on the novels, my hometown, Pasadena, had a bond issue that they passed to aid libraries. And I was so happy that it passed because so often these things don't. And they had closed a lot of branch libraries and were able to reopen them. So not everybody was going in the wrong direction. But a lot of the country still was. And what I wanted to write was a novel of someone who was coming up with solutions of a sort. My main character's solution is, grows from another religion that she comes up with. Religion is everywhere. There are no human societies without it, whether they acknowledge it as religion or not. So I thought religion might be an answer as well as, in some cases, a problem. And in, for instance, Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents, it's both. So I have people who are bringing America to a kind of fascism because their religion is the only one they're willing to tolerate. On the other hand, I have people who are saying, well, here is another religion, and here are some verses that can help us think in a different way, and here is a destination that isn't something that we have to wait for after we die.
Octavia Butler, could you read a little from Parable of the Talents?
I'm going to read a verse or two, and keep in mind these were written early in the 90s, but I think they apply forever, actually. This first one, I have a character in the books who is, someone who is taking the country fascist and who manages to get elected president. And who, oddly enough, comes from Texas. And here is one of the things that my character is inspired to write about this sort of situation. She says, "Choose your leaders with wisdom and forethought. To be led by a coward is to be controlled by all that the coward fears. To be led by a fool is to be led by the opportunists who control the fool. To be led by a thief is to offer up your most precious treasures to be stolen. To be led by a liar is to ask to be lied to. To be led by a tyrant is to sell yourself and those you love into slavery." And there's one other that I thought I should read because I see it happening so much. I got the idea for it when I heard someone answer a political question with a political slogan. And he didn't seem to realize that he was quoting somebody. He seemed to have thought that he had a creative thought there. And I wrote this verse. Beware, all too often we say what we hear others say. We think what we are told that we think. We see what we are permitted to see. Worse, we see what we are told that we see. Repetition and pride are the keys to this. To see and to hear even an obvious lie again and again and again may be to say it almost by reflex, then to defend it because we have said it, and at last to embrace it because we've defended it, and because we cannot admit that we've embraced and defended an obvious lie. Thus, without thought, without intent, we make mere echoes of ourselves, and we say what we hear others say. Just one more comment on the human condition, I guess.
Octavia Butler, a lot of the themes of your books are about being an outsider. Talk about that, and talk about what it means to be. I mean, here you are, a science fiction writer. It is rare the way you weave in issues of race, issues of power, religion. I mean, it's rare to be a black woman science fiction writer.
It's true. When I was getting started, there was one other man, Samuel R. Delaney, and he was one of my teachers. And we were having a panel discussion at a library one day, and somebody asked, well, how many of you are there? And we looked at each other and we said, we're two-thirds. There was one other man up in Canada who was writing, who has since gone a different direction. So things are better now, but there was a time when there was almost nobody. I think part of it is just because people do what they see other people doing. I had a student come up to me at Michigan State University, and this was a young black woman many years ago, and say, you know, I always loved science fiction. I've always wanted to write it, but I didn't think we did that. And she was afraid that if she got into it, there would be closed doors. And life is short. So sometimes people don't want to take the risk of running into closed doors. My friend said to me, you're doing all this, and we thought you were so brave, and after a while we decided that you just didn't have any sense. So I have never really wanted to do anything else.
When you tour around, and obviously the people who come to the readings are the fans who regularly follow you, what is your sense of your readers in terms of what they're most attracted to in your writing?
I've always had at least three groups, identifiable groups of readers. And I remember trying to convince my publishers of this early on and having no success until I went with a smaller publisher. But the groups, and they used to have their own independent bookstores. There are still a few independents left, but they were science fiction, black, and feminist, and they still are. And of course, now some mainstream. So I'm always glad that there are more readers that people find out about me. People keep telling me, "Oh, I would have read you before, but I've never heard of you."
What about the power of fundamentalist religion?
Oh, I was raised in a fundamentalist church. I was raised Baptist. One of my grandfathers was a Baptist preacher. And I'm actually grateful for one thing specifically: had that conscience installed early. And it's a monster of a conscience. I can't really get away with things. I'm not worried about being caught by other people. My own conscience is going to get me. It's when people begin using their religion as just a way of getting power over other people that scares me. And I'm afraid that's what's going on in a lot of cases right now. When people deliberately tell lies, creationism, for instance, and pretend, it's not really religion. I mean, they know they're lying, and yet they're the religious people. Something wrong there. When people use their religion to hurt other people, to say, you have to embrace this means of sex education and not that one because our religion says so. It's a misuse. But I guess religion is such a powerful thing, it's bound to be misused.
As we wrap up this interview, for young people, as you said, that you think perhaps there are few black women science fiction writers because they haven't seen them before.
Mm-hmm. Well, there are more now. The anecdote I told you was several years ago.
But when you were a kid, mm-hmm. there
were none.
So how did you go into it?
With my eyes tightly shut, I assumed that I could do it. I wasn't being brave or even thoughtful. I wanted it, and I assumed I could have it.
So what advice do you have for young people today?
Who want to write? Oh, definitely that they should. It's difficult and sometimes impossible. I mean, here I am coming off a very long writer's block, so I can acknowledge the difficulty.
How long?
7 years. it didn't mean that I wasn't writing. Writer's block is not when I'm not writing. It's when I'm not writing anything worthwhile.
And for people who suffer from writer's block, your advice?
Keep writing. Keep writing. It's the old idea that behavior that gets rewarded tends to get repeated. If you stop writing, then you're kind of rewarding yourself with not writing. If you keep writing, after a while, your brain maybe gets the idea. I'm not sure I said that very clearly, but I hope you know what I mean. Just that if you are a writer, you can't stop writing. I used to have a teacher who said, if anything can prevent you being a writer, don't be one.
The visionary feminist black science fiction writer Octavia Butler, speaking on Democracy Now! In November 2005, in one of her final television interviews. She died on February 24th, 2006, 15 years ago this week, after a fall outside her home outside Seattle, Washington. To talk more about Octavia Butler's legacy, we're joined by the writer and activist Adrienne Marie Brown. She and the musician Toshi Regan co-host Octavia's Parables, a podcast that dives deeply into Octavia Butler's books, Parable of the Sower and Parable of the Talents. Adrienne Marie Brown is also co-editor of the book Octavia's Brood, Science Fiction Stories from Social Justice Movements. She's joining us from Detroit. It's great to have you with us, Adrienne. In fact, the last time we had you on, we were talking about Octavia. If you can just briefly talk about her biography and then her significance in the world of literature, but also this visionary look at what's happening today.
Yes. Well, thanks for the opportunity to share. I love speaking about Octavia. I'll talk about her every day if I can. She gave us 12 novels and a collection of short stories, and she took us, as she took herself, from California. She drove across country to get the story for Kindred. She took herself north to Seattle, and one of the most famous stories that we just heard about, the Parables, is her protagonist character making her way north. And as Octavia learned, and as she questioned, and as she wondered how were humans going to find a way to survive on this planet, she asked those questions and brought them into the text. And in her text, we see all the ways that she was trying to answer those questions, trying to trouble the waters, trying to give us nothing easy, but something super compelling to look forward to. So the work that she did, Walida Imarisha and I, when we did Octavia's Brood, Walida called it visionary fiction, to look ahead at the future and then write ourselves in. And that's what Octavia was doing with all of her work.
And talk about her life, what led her to write. We've heard some of her describing that herself. And the whole genre of Afrofuturism, what that means.
Yeah, so she talks about this, that when she was, I think, 9, 10 years old, she saw The Devil Girl from Mars, and she said, I could write something better than that. And so she started to write things. She started to write her own short stories, her own novels. And she had the idea for the Patternist series when she was quite young and kept writing it, kept writing it. It ended up being her first novel. She wrote the series backwards. So if you read the stories, I always love knowing that when you read The Pattern Master, that was the first one, but then she wrote backwards to find out the source of that story, how we would get there. But she was a worker, so she was a laborer. She was always working, and her writing process would be waking up at 3 o'clock in the morning because she needed to do it. She had what she called positive obsession, a positive obsession with moving these stories out. And I think it would be remiss of me not to say that, just like many of us, she was looking at the world around her and feeling terrified and feeling like, how are we going to change this? What happens if this goes on? And it led her to write things that ended up feeling very prophetic. You know, in the parables, there's a president who runs for office on the slogan, Make America Great. And there's a way that she took what was happening around her, what she saw as a very shy, introverted, powerful Black woman with a super sexy underbite. She was looking at the world around her and figuring out, like, how do I think about community? How do I think about organizing? How do I think about change? And so that's how she did it in her lifetime. She wrote it onto these pages for us. Afrofuturism, I will say, is a thrilling, to me, a thrilling arena. And now there's African futurism, there's Black speculative fiction, there's all these arenas where basically Black people and people of African lineage are saying, we were almost erased from the lineage, right? People wanted to erase us and have us just be labor. We're writing ourselves back in. We're writing ourselves back in. We're creating stories that are rooted in African heritage and that articulate an African future. So it's an exciting place. It's an exciting arc to be inside of as a creator.
She is also seen, obviously, as a deeply feminist writer. How are women, especially Black women, represented in her work? And how do they grapple with the real-world power structures? I mean, even the publishing world. You have this example of, in 1987, the publisher still insisted on putting two white women on the jacket of her novel, Dawn, whose main character is Black.
Yes. I mean, so much has changed there because of the work of Octavia, because of the work of Nnedi Okorafor, because of the work of Tananarive Due. But I think one of the things that was so powerful to me when I first picked up Octavia is that she wrote these strong Black feminine characters, these protagonists, who now you might look back and see the non-binary, see the queerness, see other things in them. But at the time, she was writing these characters, and it was like, oh, there's young Black women, and they're leading. And what happened over and over again in the stories, and you see this over and over again, is that people doubted their capacity not only to lead, but to be of use in any way. And then her characters, rather than pushing, rather than fighting, they would turn inward, they would gather themselves and get aligned with what they thought. So in the parables, it's the earth seed belief system. They would get aligned and be like, I have a greater destiny than your oppression. And my destiny will take me beyond anything that your oppression can hold me from. And then over and over again, we watch those characters follow that path of destiny and take themselves and anyone who wants to come with them beyond, which I also think is important because she wrote about Black women and about Black feminism, about Black futures, but she wrote in a way that appealed to all human beings. And I think that to me is one of the essence of feminism. It's like, we're not saying we're better than or beyond. We're saying we are right here, equal to anyone else and able to lead as much as anyone else. So she understood that. She wrote it beautifully.
Adrian Marie Brown, I want to thank you for being with us, co-host of the podcast Octavia's Parables. We will link to your podcast, and also co-editor of the book Octavia's Brood, Science Fiction Stories from Social Justice Movements. On Wednesday, Symphony Space in New York will present an all-star celebration of Octavia Butler to mark the 15th anniversary of her death, and that'll be virtually. You can check it out online. Democracy Now! Is produced with Renee Feltz, Mike Burke, Dina Guzder, Libby Rainey, Nermeen Sheikh, Maria Tarasena, Carla Wills, Tammy Warren, Trina Ndura. I'm Amy Goodman. Thanks so much for joining us. Stay safe.